MCC family, how are you? Hard to believe. It's Easter and we're not together. Who would have thought that? If we'd gone clear back to Christmas and someone had said, you know what, we better enjoy this time together because we won't be together at Easter, I think we'd have thought they were crazy, but it is what it is and we're going to make the most of it. I tell you, it's not the craziest thing I've ever seen on Easter. I go back several years when we were in Tucson and our church decided that we would have an outdoor Easter gathering. Now we're talking about a couple thousand people. And so the weeks leading up to it, all we talked about is how do we accommodate people when it's so warm? Because in Tucson this time of year, we're talking 80 to 90 degrees. So we ordered case after case after case of water and we set up medical tents. We were going to do all that and we got prepared and it snowed 3 inches on Easter morning. So instead of outside, we moved inside. So it's not the strangest thing that we're not all inside together, but again, it is what it is, and we're going to make the most of it. I am right now on the baseball field at the high school. Not sure if it's illegal or not, but it is what it is, and I'm here. And the reason I'm here is because other than being together as a church, this is one of our favorite places to be as a family. You know, we're a baseball family, and we thought by now we would have logged hundreds of hours out here this spring, but it's just not going to happen. I brought this along with me, and I want you to guess, whoever you're sitting with, your family, friends, what this is. Go for it. If you guessed bat, you're wrong. You're wrong. This isn't a bat. They call this a fungo. Fungo, isn't that a great word? It's a fungo. The difference is it's a little longer, it's a lot narrower, it's a lot lighter, and they're made for old fat coaches so that we can swing them a lot and it not wear us out. So I brought the fungo because it reminds me that I know it would be a lot more fun to go to church. Instead, we're going to be the church all over this city and all over this county. The other thing I wanted to do here, though, is I wanted to interview a couple guys. One of them you know, most of you know, it's our youngest son who was really preparing up till 3 weeks ago to play his final season on this field at the high school after years and years of playing. And obviously, we're going to talk a little bit about that, and he'll have his buddy Emmert with him. And I just want to ask them a couple questions, but there's one story in particular I want you to hear from their lips. So welcome these guys into our little conversation. Emmert. And so guys, thanks for joining me.
No problem.
Thank you. Oh my goodness. You guys are part of just a rare group of people who came in on 9/11. In fact, Dylan was born on that day, 9/11. And you're going out of high school during a pandemic. How crazy is that?
It's really crazy. It's kind of unbelievable. You know, it's nothing's ever happened like that before. So we kind of feel special, but also not too special at the same time. So.
Yeah, I agree with Dylan. Like, it's honestly, it's incredible. Like, nothing's happened like this before. And it's history in the makings, but right now, for us, it's not a great history making.
Okay. All right. So how long have you guys played baseball together?
About 10 years.
10 years.
10 years. Yeah. 10 years. These guys are 18, so over half their life, they have been on the baseball field together. And so now you have played probably your last game. It doesn't look good to get back to the season. So after all the work you guys have put into, and I'm not talking just about the 10 years, but the intense work over the last 8 months to prepare for this moment, and now it's not happening. How are you dealing with that?
Honestly, for me, it's not too good. I mean, I love baseball. I mean, I've been training. We've been training really hard. We were really excited about this group of guys this year. We really, you know, like, knew each other. We were really close to each other, and we were really excited about the season to get going to see how far we would make it this year. And then something like this happened. It really sucks. But yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely hard. You know, we had a good team, close-knit group. We worked hard through the off season. kept each other accountable, really tried to get better through the off season, and then just one day it's just gone and we can't get that back. So it's kind of crazy.
It is crazy. And I want to jump now to the last thing I want to talk to you about. And that is that one of the last times you guys were on the field together, you were playing on this field late last season. And I'm looking out, you guys are looking out to center field, left field, where you both play. And then there's a spot out there in left center field where during this one game that was a very important game, we were either tied or just ahead in the game. It was only about three innings into the game, and a ball was hit into left center. And I want you guys to describe what happened.
I'll go first.
Go ahead.
We were playing Central, and there was a shallow ball that was hit. And we have this rule in the outfield where like you're supposed to call each other off. And so it was hit more towards Dylan's side of the field. So at first I told him I thought he was going to get it. And then I looked over at him and he was it looked like he was having trouble. So I took off and I'm like, well, he needs help. So I took off and I did not look up till like the very last moment. I was diving for the ball. And then I glanced and Dylan's diving for the ball at the same time. And before you know it, we both just hit each other full on, like full speed. And It was pretty bad.
It was one huge collision, I can tell you that much. And they won't tell you this, but these are probably two of the fastest, if not the fastest, young guys in this whole town. And so when they took off full speed and collided, it was the shot heard around the world. Dylan, your turn.
Yeah, it was a shallow ball. We both just went at it full speed, 100%, sprinting after it, and then we both dove, my head went into his ribs. We kind of just laid each other out. It was pretty rough.
I really appreciate those guys coming and hanging out, talking to us. This is a challenging time for them, as it is with a lot of people in our culture today. But that moment that they described was really important. It was actually what I would call a game-changing moment. I mean, as parents, and we were right next to Emmert's parents, it was scary. I mean, our kids were down for some 15 minutes. If you know Caleb, our older son, he ran out there to check on his brother. He was so nervous about what was going on. Well, they were injured, and Dylan would have a concussion and would miss several games after that. Emmert would miss a few games. That game was changed on that moment. We were in good shape, and we ended up losing. The team kind of fell apart in shock of what they'd just seen. But the whole season was different from that moment on as well. We never know when those game-changing moments are going to take place. Our oldest son played on this field, behind home plate there. He actually coached from this dugout for a few years. He had a game-changing moment, didn't know it was coming. He had received an opportunity to go to Haiti as a mission intern for Mission of Hope. It happened quickly, he was excited, jumped on the plane. On his flight to Miami, where he would spend the night waiting to go on to Port-au-Prince, we received word that there was a virus sweeping across that Caribbean island. And it was scary. People didn't know what it was about. They didn't know what the long-term ramifications were of this virus. It was called chikungunya. How's that for a good name for a virus? I like it better than the one we have now. But good news is he had a great summer. 10 weeks. Life-changing. He didn't ever get the chikungunya virus. He knew someone who did, though. There was a young gal who was finishing up her nursing degree, and she lived in Savannah, Georgia. And this would give him an opportunity to sit down and talk to her because she was pretty much immobile. And being the compassionate, caring guy he is, he was there to help her out however he could. I want to believe he had pure motives. Anyway, the bottom line is 6 years later, they're married, they have two beautiful sons. None of us knew that night that he spent praying and asking God, what shall I do? And God's response to him was, if you're gonna get sick, you're gonna get sick, go. Well, that was a game-changing moment. I wanna tell you one more, it's a baseball story, of course. It's about an 11-year-old boy who loved baseball, wanted to be a Major League Baseball player. He was geared up for summer baseball, his 11-year-old life, and he found out that he had contracted mononucleosis. If you know anything about that illness, it's very contagious. He had to be quarantined all summer long. Can you imagine parents having an 11-year-old boy quarantined in the summer for the entire summer? He became despondent, even depressed. And so his father took action. He said, we're not gonna just sit around here and feel sorry for ourselves. He taught him how to play guitar. Almost a chord a day is what he taught him. All these years later, you would know that little 11-year-old boy now as Chris Tomlin. If you don't know who that is, Google him and you'll find him to be one of the finest Christian artists, singers, worship leaders of our time. But he points back to that moment in his life when he was despondent. He had no idea that his life was about to change so radically. It was a game-changing moment for him. Those moments come when we least expect them, and we want to talk more about that. So we've changed venues, did you notice? A little different than a ballpark. And as much as I love the ballpark, and I do, spend a lot of time there, I might love this place even more. Honestly, I love cemeteries. There's just something about them. I mean, they're almost always quiet. If it's not quiet, you can be concerned. But people are, there's no one here, you know? And you may not realize this, I'm an introvert, so this is my kind of place. No one's here. There's remains of what were people, but they're gone. They've left. And so I just thoroughly enjoy places like this. I enjoy looking at the gravestones, the markers, the engravings, and especially that line, the dash. We've talked about the dash before, right? Before the number that states the birth and the number that states leaving this earth, and then there's that dash. Your whole life is that dash. In the end, that's what it comes down to, that dash. And maybe that's what I love about places like this. It reminds me that we are temporary. As much as we forget that every day, and as much as we want to pretend like we can be here forever, it is temporary. And so that should change some of our priorities. If we realize that time is fleeting, it's short. For some folks who are being remembered in this big grassy area, for some people it was a very short time on earth, and for others it was long but still temporary, not as long as the life to come. And maybe, just maybe, the thing I love the most about this place is that it reminds me of Jesus' impact on the world. Yeah, his impact on the world made it so that this place is not the end. I want to read to you from a passage that Paul writes that states how important it is that we understand that. Okay, I'm going to read it from the Message. In your notes, I'll have it there in the NIV, so you've got it in both ways. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So let me read it to you. He says, friends, let me go over the message with you one final time. The message that I proclaimed and that you made your own. This message on which you took your stand and by which your life has been saved. Right there, there's an assumption, and that is that we're in trouble without this message. We're hosed without this. We need being saved. And then he says this, now I'm assuming that your belief was the real thing. And not a passing fancy, that you're in this for good and you're holding fast. That's his assumption. You're holding fast. You're in this for the long haul. What is this that he's talking about? He says it now. So the first thing, the most important thing is the idea. The most important thing I did was to place before you what was placed so emphatically before me. Here it is. This is the moment. What is the first thing? What is the most important thing? What is the thing you gotta know? You gotta understand. You ready? The Messiah died for our sins, exactly as the scripture tells it. That he was buried, and that he was raised from the dead the third day. He goes on to say, basically, he kind of taunts anyone that doubts it in that day and age. He probably wrote this about 30 years after Jesus died, was buried, and rose from the dead. And he basically says, if you don't believe me, go talk to people. Because he appeared to a lot of people, over 500 people. And he says some of them have passed on, but a lot of them are around. All you have to do is go verify this. And I love that. He's so confident. He says, you know, these people will tell you they saw the risen Lord. And how important is the fact that he rose from the dead? We often focus on the crucifixion, and rightly so, because it was there that the penalty was paid. But he goes on in verse 14 of chapter 15 to say this: if Christ wasn't raised, then all you're doing is wandering around in the dark, lost as ever. It's even worse for those who died hoping in Christ and resurrection because they're already in their graves. If we all get out of Christ a little inspiration, it'll only be for a few short years. We're a pretty sorry lot. So in other words, if all you're going to get out of this life with Christ is, boy, he inspired me to live a certain way, he says, then we're a sorry lot. Then we end up in the cemetery like everybody else, and that's the end. Then he finishes this way: Christ has been raised up, the first in a long legacy of those who are going to leave the cemeteries. Isn't that great? He was the first to leave the cemeteries. And if you study the life of Jesus, you know that he wasn't a big fan of death. I mean, don't you agree? Are you a big fan of death? I mean, he wasn't a big fan of the facade of death. Every funeral he went to, he destroyed it. I mean, he just destroyed it. In all the mourning, you know, he would say, step aside. It was true of every funeral he went to that he raised him from the dead to show, I have power over death. And that's what I see when I come here. It's just a reminder that this is not the end, that he has power and he's risen. And that affects my life and your life 2,000 years later. And it has affected the entire world. It is the greatest game changer of all time for all people, no matter where they live. It is the game changer. And all you have to do is look around. If you compare what the world was like before he came, and then after he was there, after he rose from the dead, and again, if he just dies on the cross and he doesn't raise from the dead, he's no different than anybody else that died on the cross, or anybody else that died in any form or fashion, right? It's his resurrection. The death was necessary. The blood being shed was essential to the new covenant, but it was his resurrection that changed the world. The world that he went into, the world that he was born into, oh my goodness, it was so discriminatory towards women. I mean, women played such a minor role in that world. And he came along and changed all that. There was actually a Jewish prayer book that was used in those days where the Jewish man would pray the following prayer every day: God of heaven, I thank thee that I am not a Gentile. I thank thee that I am not a slave, and I thank thee that I'm not a woman. How would that prayer go over in your home? Probably not well, and it shouldn't go over very well. Jesus changed everything. And sometimes we forget that, the way the world was then. I heard this story, I'll relate to you. It's about a CEO who was traveling with his wife, and it was back in the day, so the old people watching this, you need to explain this to the younger people. They pulled up to a gas station, and the gas station had an attendant, a guy who came out and, you know, he pumped your gas for you and checked your oil and checked the tires, washed down the windshield, all those things. There used to be a time when that happened. And so they drove into this gas station, and that's what took place. And when it was all said and done, the guy got up and went into the store, into the gas station, and paid. While he was gone, his wife got talking to the gas station attendant, and they discovered they knew each other. They had dated each other in high school. They were great friends, hadn't seen each other in years. Had a great conversation. Her husband, the CEO, promptly came back out and noticed the conversation and exchanged pleasantries, got in the car, and they drove off. And he said, who was that? And she said, that was a guy I knew in high school. We dated. And then it was real quiet for a second. And then he said, I bet I know what you're thinking. She said, what? I bet you're thinking you're sure glad you married a CEO instead of the gas attendant, right? It was quiet for a second. She says, actually, that wasn't what I was thinking. He said, it wasn't? Then what were you thinking? She said, actually, what I was thinking is that if I had married him, he would have become a CEO and you'd be a gas attendant. See, women back in those days would never have told that joke. I mean, they would never have been so brave as to say something like that, because the deck was stacked against them. And yet Jesus comes along, and the longest conversation he has with any one person that's recorded in the Gospels is with a woman. Unbelievable. In fact, it was so strange for a man to talk to a woman in public that when his disciples came back from getting food, gone to McDonald's, they got back, they looked at him and they said, what's going on here? Like, what are you doing? This is against the rules. We don't do this. She's a nobody. She's a nothing. Jesus didn't feel that way. In fact, speaking of the resurrection, you know who found the tomb empty first? Women. Women, as God ordained it, women found the tomb empty first. Did you know that a woman in that day and age couldn't even testify in court? Her word was worth nothing in court. So everything changed when Jesus came. Dietrich Bonhoeffer put it something like this. He said, women were of no value before Jesus, but he brought dignity to women. And that's exactly what happened. Not just women, children. Children were of no value. They would toss a child out for no reason at all. It was called the law of exposure. If you didn't want a child, because especially if it was a girl, but if it was anything wrong with the child, or you just didn't want to have another child, you decided, just throw them out. Let them die. When Jesus came along, and that's how they all felt about kids, Jesus came along and the children came running up to him, and that's why the disciples said, get away, and tried to shoo him away. His response was, leave him alone. Leave him alone. He put him on his lap and he said, for such is the kingdom of God. If you don't become like them, you don't get to be a part of the kingdom of God. See, these things were revolutionary. And it's the risen Jesus, because he rose from the dead, that this stuff stuck. And these values changed. How about compassion? Did you know that compassion was unheard of before Jesus came on the scene? Absolutely unheard of. You know, the great diseases that swept through Rome and the known world. I mean, there was a smallpox in 169 AD epidemic that killed a third to two-thirds of the people. A century later, there was another epidemic that came into Rome, and 5,000 people died every day. 5 million people died in totality. And during this time, it's interesting that the Greek gods and the Roman gods had given them no instructions other than preserve yourself. And so family members would actually throw other family members into the street to die, saying, sorry, can't touch you, can't be around you. That's the way the world was in the time of Jesus. And after Jesus' resurrection, it was a different world, right? I mean, in the third century, a historian wrote about these epidemics that came through, and he talked about a community of people. And I want to read it to you because I want to get the words correct. Here's what he wrote. Heedless of the danger, they took charge of the sick, attending to their every need and ministering to them in Christ. And with them departed this life sincerely happy, for they were infected by others with the disease, drawing on themselves the sickness of their neighbors and cheerfully accepting their pains. What was that little community of people? They were called the Way. They're called people who followed Jesus. And it was shortly after that that hospitals became essential. It was said in Europe that where we build a church, we will build a hospice, a place to care for the sick and dying. And that was the beginning of what we know as hospitals. You know, it doesn't matter what segment of life we look at, the resurrected Jesus, and it's the resurrected Jesus, not just Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, who set himself apart from all others because the grave could not hold him. He was the great grave robber.
and it changed the world. It changed the culture in which we live. The reason we even care to take time out of our busy schedules is to probably do our best to help those who cannot help themselves with this illness. It's kind of what Jesus did. I mean, it is really what he did. So I got to tell you, these are great days. You may not feel like it right now, but these are great days. And I'm going to tell you why in just a moment. So we've been to the ballpark, we've been to the cemetery, and now here we are. There is something about this idea that we are in the moment of game change. We really are. The greatest game change of all time has taken place, but we're in one of those moments right now. If you're watching right now and it's Saturday, do you realize that on this day, Saturday, 50 years ago exactly, Apollo 13 launched, and their goal was to be the third manned spacecraft to land on the moon. Well, if you know the story, or at least you watched the movie, you know that didn't happen. 2 days into the flight, things went haywire and everything changed. It was no longer about landing on the moon. It was now about how do we get these guys home? And that's really what the story becomes about in the movie as they depict it. And I think they did a great job, because now it wasn't land, now it was loop them around the moon, get them back home. And it was a crazy difficult thing to accomplish. But accomplish it they were doing until the last real large hurdle. And the last hurdle was, as they entered into our atmosphere, the concern was that the heat shields on their spacecraft had been damaged during the explosion, and that they could not endure the heat of coming back into our atmosphere. There was about a 4 minute period, what they called blackout, where they would not hear from these guys. And their concern was that they would never hear from these guys again. There's a great moment at this part in the movie where Gene Kranz, who is the flight director, he is known for his cropped hair and his vest he would wear. He was having a conversation with some engineers, and then he had a conversation with the director of NASA. And here's how it went. The director of NASA said, "I think this is going to be the worst disaster we've ever had." To which Gene Kranz looked him in the eye, and I'm pretty sure it actually happened this way, and he said, "Sir, with all due respect, I think this will be our finest moment." Well, if you know the story, it was. They lived, they survived. But it's that idea. We look around at the culture right now, and people, they're losing it. I mean, they're scared. And yet, the message for us today, I believe, because of the resurrection, is that we have nothing to fear. We have nothing to be concerned about, really, because we know that God is sovereign and He has everything under control. But indeed, this might be our finest moment. And that's what I want to encourage you with here today. This could be your finest moment. This could be the finest moment for your family. This could be the finest moment for the church. It's highly possible. I want to take you back to another time in history, clear back to 597 BC. I don't know what you were doing at that time, but something very significant happened. The king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, led a campaign to go into Jerusalem and to sack Jerusalem, to capture the people of Jerusalem, to decimate their city. And he took them, he would later come back into Judea and take more Jewish people, he took them back to Babylon. And there they were held captive for some 60 years. After 60 years, he became the victim of the very thing that he had propagated on the Jewish people. The Persian king, Cyrus, overtook his kingdom. And so now Persia increased their kingdom by at least twice as much. But now the Jewish people, their position had not changed. They were still captives in a foreign land. And so it's that setting that I want to tell you about. 120 years has passed
probably three generations. So the people living there in Persia now that are Jewish, they've heard the stories, but they never lived in Jerusalem. They don't know what it was like. There was one gal in particular, her name is Esther, and you're probably ahead of me. I'm talking about the book of Esther and what it recorded historically that happened. You see, the king of Persia, his name was Xerxes, which is an awesome name. If you're thinking about a name for your next son, I don't think it would go so good for a daughter. But Xerxes was really into beautiful women, and his wife, Queen Vashti, was beautiful. She was gorgeous. He had a huge celebration, and as part of the celebration at some point, they probably drank too much and eat too much, watched too much football, but he wanted his wife to come out and walk amongst his guests and impress them with her beauty. So he sends a message to Vashti, and she snubs him. I mean, she just snubs him. She just basically says, not going to do it. Now, King Xerxes probably had never had that happen before. He didn't. This part gets kind of comical. He didn't know what to do. He turned to his advisors, his council, and he said, what do I do? I've never had a woman or anyone but my wife telling me she won't do what I'm telling her to do. What do I do? And he went through a lot of options, but finally they said, bottom line is you got to do something. And it was so funny because it was typical men saying, you know, if you don't do something about your wife, then I'm going to have the same problem with my wife. And all throughout our country, chaos will reign. We'd rather have a virus. Loose translation. But bottom line is, he says, okay, I'll get a new queen. So there's this beauty pageant that takes place over about a period of a year. And lo and behold, they choose Esther. They don't know, the king doesn't know that she's Jewish. Because her cousin had raised her. Her parents had died when she was young. And her cousin said, when you go before the king and when you go before those people who are going to dress you up, don't tell them you're Jewish. You'll never get the gig. And so the bottom line is Esther becomes the queen. And from that point on, you know, it gets really crazy. There's this conspiracy to kill all the Jews. Mordecai, her cousin, says, hey, you got to go talk to the king. She says, may I remind you that if I'm not summoned, I'll lose my head. And he says this to her. It's a very famous line. He says, you know, I believe it was for such a time as this that you were made queen. God had his hand on this. This is miraculous. This is a God thing. You need to step up. And you'll have to read the rest of the story, but it's that idea of this was a game-changing moment for the Jewish people. Game-changing moments are all around us, but we just don't know when they're coming at us. We don't know when we're in them sometimes. I want to tell you that we right now are in a game-changing time, a game-changing moment, if you will. You know, Jesus stood up in John chapter 7. He was at the festival and in Jerusalem, and he stood up at the end of the festival on what John said was the last and greatest day of the festival. And he cried out in a loud voice. He said, all those who are thirsty can come to me, and I will take care of them. And then he goes on to say, just as the scriptures say, that those who believe in me, a river of life will flow through them. And John then comments on it. He says, by that he meant the Spirit of God. Here's the great thing. Not only is Jesus risen from the dead, and we talked about that at the cemetery, but now, because of that, he, through his Spirit, lives in us and flows through us. This is our opportunity. Don't try harder to be a nice person. Let God's Spirit flow through you and make a difference in this game-changing moment that we're in, a difference in your life. Take the time. You now have time to seek God earnestly. You know, no more of this, I'm too busy, all this, when I have time someday. Take time in your marriage. In your marriage. I don't know how it's going. Now that you're spending a lot more time together, it could be a good thing. Not, I don't know. I saw a meme the other day where a guy said, I just found out how much my wife loves me because I woke up in the morning and she had a pillow over my face. She was protecting me from the COVID virus. Yeah, well, I don't know how that's going. This is a chance that could end up being a game-changing time in your marriage. How about for your family? Be proactive, just like Chris Tomlin's dad did. Make it happen so that you experience the oneness in your family, the unity that you were meant to. And now, the church. I believe, it's my conviction, I'm not here advertising for anyone else, I believe this truly is about the church. This moment, this is a game-changing moment for the church. Honestly, we've gotten off track in a lot of ways, and it is time. I'm talking about the church in general, but it's also a game-changing moment for our church, for the church that you belong to, that you serve, that you enjoy relationships in. I believe, and we've got to just watch what God does, this could be game-changing for the future of the church. All I know is this, a river runs through it. A river runs through your life, through your marriage, through your family, through His church. A river runs through it. And that is the Spirit of God, and He brings life. Whenever you've seen a river run through a desert area, you see green, you see life wherever it goes. And it's a dry and arid time now, and people are worried and they're scared, and it's the perfect time to let them see the Spirit of God flow through us. Take advantage of this. Seize the day. Let the river flow.
Well, church, let's wrap this up. We've been on quite a journey. We've been in a couple different locations, but I hope the message was really clear that no matter what the circumstances are around us, we can see God at work, and we need to seize the day. This really is, I believe, a game-changing time for us individually and as families, our marriages, of course, and as the church as well. Now, the practical playing out of that, how that looks in your life, is going to be different based on who you are, but I gave you some practical tips in the notes that are attached to this video. So all you have to do is go to the website and you'll find the link to this video, which you've already found, but next to that you should see a link to the notes, which are actually pretty much a transcript of what we've been doing throughout this video. And hopefully you'll find those helpful. I've tried to include opportunities for you as an individual, as a marriage, your family, and for us as a church as well. Let me say just a thing or two about that real quick. I believe we as a church are wired for this. We are built for this. It's in our DNA. Here's what I mean by that. We are not a church that is built on a high level of programming or built on the building being essential to who we are. We are built on discipleship, and so many of you have been discipled. And I can speak for the groups of men that I've been a part of over the last several years. And we've talked about this, that we believed a day was coming when you would be asked to take what you've been given and turn it around and give it to others in a smaller setting. Even our Sunday morning gathering is wired this way, and I think you know that. We are not like a typical gathering. We take breaks to work through, to talk about, discuss what's going on, and interact with one another. And that has primed us for this moment in time where we have the ability to know how important it is that we are in small settings and that we do know how to interact and answer questions. And by the way, I've added those discussion questions in those notes as well, and so hopefully you'll take advantage of those. Well, have a wonderful Easter. What a special time this is. For me personally, it has extra significance. I gave my life to Christ, was baptized 50 years ago today, and it has been quite a journey. It's been quite a ride. There's not been one moment that I have regretted that commitment in my life. And so I want you to know, no matter how long you have walked with the Lord, that the truth is, it's not about always looking back to the moment you started, but realizing that every day, every morning, His mercies are new. And that is there for all of us. My hope and my prayer is that you will then focus your life on Christ, and it's His mercies every day that will become new to you, and that you will experience all that He has for you and make the most of this time. This is a game-changing time in our lives. So enjoy today. Enjoy doing whatever you're doing. Hope you get to be with some family, hopefully a couple friends maybe. But we will continue this next week. Have a wonderful week.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake. Come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead. We are one with him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from